Hello and welcome back to another video here with me, Meoni, and this is yet another interview. Basically, back-to-back interviews are releasing today, and some of them are very interesting. This one in particular, I was originally going to skip over, but it's even more interesting than the previous one. There's a lot of lore-related questions and a lot of Shadowbringers-related story, sort of like spoilers. So if you're not interested in Shadowbringers story and you've not completed 5.0, honestly, you're probably better off not watching this video. So the interview I'm talking about today was produced by Dustin Bailey over at PCGamesN.com. There will be a link in the description, the top of the description of this video, in fact, which will take you to this article, which I advise you to go and show some love because it's quite a well-produced article. Again, we have the main scenario writer, Natsuko Ishikawa, and additionally, we have Takeo Suzuki here as well, which is the art team lead. Final Fantasy XIV has been building its story and world over the course of many years. Do you have an outline of where you want it to go over time, or do you start fresh with every update? Ishikawa says, as a base, we do have different areas and regions that are already established in the world, as well as some of the lore. It's kind of like picking from the options we have available. That being said, of course, we do have toys in our toy box. We try to figure out which of these elements best fit that particular timing, depending on what we're doing with the expansion. Sometimes there may be elements where there is an established lore and we have an option to go in one certain direction, but sometimes we might decide that we want to do something brand new. Let's go to the moon or something. So we do look at where we're going when we do an expansion and see how our players feel and what the reception was like from the previous expansion or how we want to take our narrative. Isfen asks, is there any specific element that you've brought to Shadowbringers that you're especially proud of? Suzuki first takes this question. The art team's big challenge was introducing the new races, the Hrothgar and the Viera. The Hrothgar are very distinctive, they're not human-like, and lean very much towards the beast-like look. I'm very proud of how that came out. Ishikawa-san says, when we went to the first, which is a completely different location from where our adventures took place up to until this point, I'm very happy to see that a lot of players enjoyed the base story of Final Fantasy XIV, but also the story that took place in the first. The reception was really good. People seem to fall in love with the realm of the first. I'm very proud that we were able to deliver a new location, but still have a very rich story to it. Dustin asks, we've heard that A Realm Reborn's main quest is getting condensed in a future update. Will that affect some of the details of the story? And if so, does that affect your approach in writing the plot going forward? Ishikawa says, to offer some clarification on the streamlining of the A Realm Reborn quest, we're trying to trim it down. We don't want to destroy the story experience of the earlier narrative. We just wanted to look at some of the quests that are strung together in particular quest lines. If you're trying to get from point A to point B, and there are extra tasks that are not as important as some of the key points, we would remove them. Especially with the questline after the base A Realm Reborn game. Patches 2.1 through 2.5, your player character is level 50 at that point, and people were very eager to get into Ishgard. There were a lot of requests, so to speak, so we're trying to review what we can streamline in that process. As you are going through the story quest, you will still encounter those people that you need to meet. We don't intend on changing the general framework of how the narrative is supposed to carry itself throughout these patches. You can rest assured there. I don't think we will change how we will write our stories in the future. Isven asks, do you work closely with a localization team as you're developing the story? Ishikawa says, for sure, yes, there's really close communication. With the game being available in multiple languages, we have to do it simultaneously. We don't want a situation where we release certain content and it differs between languages. The scenario team and the localization team are actually on the same floor of the office. We consult each other on a regular basis and communicate over instant message and Skype. The localization team might submit a list of questions on certain elements of a scenario, and we make sure that we're all aligned so that the questions will be answered. Suzuki says, the art team actually works with the localization team as well. Whenever we are showing different animations or emotes, things like that, there may be some gestures that would apply to a Japanese audience, but not necessarily to a Western audience. Sometimes we receive advice from a localization team, but we might want to change certain ways of expressing things to convey them correctly across a global audience. The same goes for some of the cutscenes. We have planning documents that lay out what we want to do, and a localization team might chime in saying, can we change it to something like this, so that it's more culturally recognizable in different countries. Dustin asks, has anything surprised you in how players in other regions have reacted to certain elements, as opposed to Japanese players? Ishikawa says, by the time we deliver content to players, we've already had our discussion with the localization team, so we haven't noticed much of an instance where player feedback was different between Japanese and Western audiences. But when we discuss it during development, sometimes we realize there are different ways to interpret things. There's one in particular I remember being a topic of great debate. When we think of the fist bump from a Japanese perspective, we go knuckle to knuckle, but we've been told that Westerners go side by side when they do fist bumps. Apparently Ishikawa and Suzuki actually demonstrated the various types of fist bumps in real life, which I'm sure that was entertaining to watch. Continued here, it was to be shown in a very important scene, so we had to hash it out really well. We ended up going with the side fist so that it's more easily recognizable outside of Japan, but I still hear the Japanese audience asking, why isn't it knuckle to knuckle? The question is followed up, has there ever been a gear set or a bit of a world design that looked cool in concept but just didn't work in the game itself? Suzuki says, to tell you the truth, yeah, there are times when we render something in 3D and we aren't very pleased with it, but we have really talented 3D artists on our team, so we take that rendering and tweak it during our adjustment period. We really polish and brush up the quality. We always hope that whatever we do deliver to players is the best it can be. Next question. One player mentioned how pleased they were to see so many Mesoamerican and South American references in Shadowbringers. What's your approach to bringing real cultures and mythologies into the game? Ishikawa says, we do take inspiration from different cultures and visual aspects of civilizations around the world. Mesoamerican culture in particular is something I really love, so I wanted to incorporate that in the Rakteka Greatwood. With any culture that we reference, we have to make sure that we're not literally copying and pasting it into the game. It needs to make sense within the realm it appears. If we are incorporating it into the areas of the first, or if it's back on the source, it needs to look like it belongs there. We ensure that the lore and the history we've established makes sense in the context of the overall realm of Final Fantasy XIV. Suzuki's answer to this, the same goes for the art side as well. There may be some requests from the different designers and game planners to take reference to different civilizations or different aspects of other cultures, so the art team will also think about how it's going to blend in with the realm of the first. What kind of history would it have taken if it were in that area? We rack our brains on the background of how we're going to incorporate it. There's a huge spoiler section here, and this does, in fact, this next section onwards, spoil Shadowbringers' story, so this is your last chance if you don't want to hear any of that spoiler information. Toward the end of Shadowbringers, players defeat Hades without imprisoning him in the White Aura Site, but Lahabrea was defeated in a similar way and eventually returned. Is Hades done for good? Ishikawa says, with Lahabrea, he wasn't literally put into the White Aura Site, but he was absorbed into the Dragon's Eye and Astinian pierced it. Although he wasn't imprisoned in the White Aura Site, you can technically say he's in the same situation. When Hades revealed his true form and his soul was there, we didn't capture it in the White Aura Site. He was held down and pierced with a stake, basically. He was captured and not able to move at that point, and then the Warrior of Light struck him with the blow. So it is believed that Hades has been completely destroyed. Dustin asks, did Ardbert's soul join with the Warrior of Light, or was that a temporary transfer of power? Ishikawa says, it's a sort of merger between Ardbert and the Warrior of Light. It's followed up, will we ever learn who the Warrior of Light's soul used to belong to? Ishikawa says, forebodingly, we shall see. Next question. One player mentioned that their favourite part of the story was the interaction between Fancred and Urianjay at Amareng. What's your approach to writing and revising a scene like that? Ishikawa says, first and foremost, we make sure that we establish the characters individually. I try to think about the character to the point where I know exactly who they are, and there's no deviating from their characteristics. In the scene with Thancred and Urian J, Thancred now has this person he really wants to protect, which is Minfilia. I wanted to depict this new feeling of a bond towards someone he feels like family. He's never felt that before. I wanted to bring that out. On the other hand, Urian J is very gentle and kind, but his choice of words tends to be very snobby, very holier than thou. So with this scene, we wanted to bring out the fact that he's now being more careful in how he communicates with others. You have those two characters, and then we have Minfilia, who has her own feelings in her heart. From there, I try to see how we can properly convey what each of them are feeling individually, but at the same time, bring it together. And finally, the last question. Finally, is there any significance to the shoe bill that keeps showing up in the main story of Shadowbringers? Ishikawa says, it could be a very important character. Maybe, because it does appear in the level 80 Amarot dungeon. It could potentially be something very important. With that being said, it is very much shrouded in mystery. It has been observing our Warriors of Light from afar. When you look back, there it is. So it might be quite a challenge to unravel what mystery it contains. All we're short of now is a dun dun dun, and then, you know, that's pretty much it, isn't it? What a cliffhanger. What an incredible interview. The second half of this with the spoilers. I didn't think they were actually going to answer some of these questions, but there we go. We have a lot of foreboding answers and a lot of sort of like links to future content. I, for one, cannot wait to see the 5.1 storyline and anything post of that. But yeah, thank you once again to Dustin Bailey for your fantastic interview for PCGamesN.com. A link in the top of the description of this video below will actually take you to this article. Please go and give it some love and perhaps leave a comment to say how much you enjoyed their hard work. Either way, thank you kindly for watching or listening to this video, and I'll see you all next time.